So basically, this is the problem with the whole health influencer field. If you're a true evidence-based health influencer, what are you going to promote? Sleep right, exercise, eat well. Then that gets boring after a while. And so now what do you have to do? You have to get into more and more exotic shit. You're like, okay, now let's talk about infrared saunas and icing your balls. They have to make a living, right? And so what do they make a living on? Selling stuff. They have to shill green juice, literally, and say, it's great. I take it. This is why you should take it. Maybe it's great. Maybe it's not, but they're no longer objective. There's clear biases. The thing that I find interesting as a psychologist is why have a few people in the span of literally a few years, people came out of nowhere, captured the public attention so much, and that they've literally become America's doctor. A lot of educated people are sitting there and listening to certain podcasters, and that's how they decide what to eat, how to exercise, what their morning routine is, whether alcohol is good or bad. Testosterone has roughly decreased 50% in the last 50 years. People are worried because if you extrapolate out by basically 2050, the average guy will be infertile. Men seem to be struggling in terms of functioning, educational attainment, workplace attainment. Women are basically outclassing and surpassing men in a lot of ways. I always say that the last two truth tellers in society are psychologists and comedians. Psychologists can speak freely privately, and comedians can speak freely publicly because they can get away with saying it's a joke. The whole toxic masculinity movement, it was really pushed by two particular organizations. Obviously, the purveyors of more physical violence are men, given the physiological stature. But to turn that into a problem of masculinity is, I think, where the argument really started to get very loose and also became very problematic.
One of the areas that I wanted to start on was to speak about the decline of testosterone in males over the years. I remember you speaking about this fairly early on. It went along the lines of, you're not even half the person that your father was at your age. If you can elaborate on that a bit further.
I ran across these statistics and they were alarming. And I didn't even believe them because I was like, okay, let me go look at the primary research. Let me look at the studies themselves and see if this is convincing. And the more and more I dug into the research as a scientist, I became, quite frankly, alarmed and felt that the research was actually very reliable and valid. So I'll talk about three different kind of pieces of research that I thought was very interesting. The first is the testosterone decline that you alluded to. So testosterone has roughly decreased 50% in the last 50 years. And it's a drastic phenomenon. It's happening all over the world. And in fact, it's accelerating. Total testosterone is declining, but especially bioavailable and free testosterone, which is more clinically relevant, has been declining drastically. And some people are like, oh, is it because we have different assays or tests for it? But it seems to be a pretty reliable effect. So that's the first thing that's happening. And a lot of people were like, this is unsurprising. People are getting fatter. People are getting sicker. And that is certainly a contributing factor. But even when they control for obesity, diabetes, other potential obvious explanatory factors, it's still going down. And in fact, there are lots of healthy, young, fit people who, to your point, have less testosterone than their fathers and grandfathers. And so the question is, why is that? And the hypothesis is that there's essentially endocrine disrupting chemicals in our food, in our water, literally in our clothing, bedding, carpeting, your Teflon coated pans, the receipts that you touch, you absorb BPA into your bloodstream. Even all the aluminum cans are not actually aluminum. They're actually lined with a plastic that prevents the corrosion of the aluminum because Coca-Cola and other beverages are acidic. So you're constantly consuming these microplastics. In fact, you probably consume a credit card size amount of microplastics every week is what they're saying. We don't even know it because they're so small. That's why they're called microplastics. But there was a recent study that in fact showed that 77% of people in a small sample have literally plastic in their blood. And the specific types of plastics are the most common ones that are used in disposable plastic water bottles and the packaging and foods. And so we don't realize this because these blood tests are not commonly done. If you are curious, there's a company called Million Marker that does test for BPA, BPS, LHs. So these are the common, what are called xenoestrogens. They're essentially synthetic estrogens or endocrine disrupting chemicals, EDCs, that disrupt hormone profile. And they disproportionately affect men because, interestingly, there aren't xenoandrogens in the environment. There aren't like synthetic testosterones, but there are synthetic estrogens. And for men, it knocks their hormones out of balance. So that's the first thing that's happening. The second thing that was really interesting is the fertility decline. So it's not just testosterone that's coming down, but these markers of fertility in terms of sperm count and sperm motility, which are essential for reproduction. That's also been going down. It's actually dropped. Total sperm count has dropped 62.4% between the periods of 1973 and 2018. So that's even a smaller span of time, 45 years, you're seeing a 62% decline. And the thing that's also alarming is that it's accelerating. That decline was like 1.16% from 1972 to 1999. And since 2000, since the turn of the millennium, it's actually increased to, I believe, 2.64% per year. It's declining. People are worried because if you extrapolate out by basically 2050, the average guy will be infertile. There'll be sperm count zero, essentially. Now, I don't think it's literally the end of the human species and that there are probably going to be some men that are fertile, some men that are not. But increasingly, even anecdotally, you're seeing this. If you talk to couples in their 30s, there's a tremendous amount that have to undergo IVF. And 50% of idiopathic infertility is male caused. It's typically, unfortunately, women get the blame, but it's often due to men and their essentially unviable sperm. The interesting thing about this testosterone and sperm count decline, it's not just in humans, but it's in our dogs as well. So it's not a uniquely human phenomenon. So it's cross species. And it's literally found in people in every single continent in the world where humans live. So it seems to be this global endemic phenomenon that's happening. And I was like, very few people are talking about this. Very few people are doing anything about this. And then I was like, what's the psychological impact of all this? And interestingly, when you ask and do surveys across different age groups, if you ask men, for instance, over the age of 65, so people our father's age, 82% consider themselves highly masculine. If you ask men under 30 in the United States, so men aged 18 to 29, below 50%, it's the first time in American history the minority of men actually consider themselves masculine. Now, I think it's partly because their testosterone has dropped. They literally feel less male. But secondarily, I think masculinity has become a dirty word. It's toxic, according to Gillette and other forces. And so people may not want to self-identify as masculine anymore. So all of these forces were happening at the same time. And when I ran across this, I was like, this is really terrible because there's no good solution to it. Testosterone replacement therapy, which is the gold standard treatment, ironically, makes men more infertile. It's actually a male contraceptive. There's a paper literally called testosterone is a male contraceptive and should not be used in anyone who wants to maintain their fertility. And men aren't really educated about that. It really became a personal mission to me to be like, this is a huge public health problem. Nobody's really talking about it. And most importantly, no one's doing anything about it. And so I started Maximus, a company, to literally address these three crises.
About the microplastics in the environment, you mentioned quite a few objects that you come into contact with, some that you probably don't even realize. It almost seems as if it's not quite a simple case of I will consciously cut out these particular elements from my life, because it just doesn't seem plausible or feasible. And you're gonna have to put in a tremendous amount of effort to try and rid yourself of that. But even things like receipts or many of the other products that you've mentioned, they didn't seem like a viable alternative to that.
I partly agree. We can't get to zero, but I don't think we need to. I think the Pareto principle or the 20-80 rule applies here. Probably 20% of our exposure accounts for 80% of the damage. There's probably a few things that are primarily responsible, and those can make a disproportionate impact. Obviously, being in the mental health field, and literally I'm an anxiety disorders expert, I don't want to encourage people to become OCD, right, about this sort of thing. But I think there's some basic stuff that you can do. The basic ones that I tell everyone to do is your cookware. So just use cast iron, because the only thing that's going to scrape off of a cast iron pan is iron. And it's not too bad to get a little bit of extra iron. The second thing is try to minimize the containers that are plastic. So I just switched to using stainless steel or glass for carrying my food and beverages. That's going to be a glass container only. So I think those two things, and then filtering your water, like those three things will probably actually make a disproportionate impact. And in fact, there's some anecdotal evidence that may work. Dr. Yusuf, he's a physician in the UK. You should check out his YouTube channel, Series of Experiments, where he takes a lot of these biohacking concepts, endocrine disrupting chemicals, red light therapy, etc. And he measures his hormones pre and after. And ironically, like a lot of the biohacking stuff, the ice baths, whatever, icing your balls, all this silly stuff, it never moves the needle in terms of increasing his testosterone. But the one thing that I think did was actually the efforts that he made to reduce his endocrine disrupting chemicals. And it wasn't too onerous. I think it was a lot of basic stuff and maybe cutting down on some of the cosmetics, I believe, because your skincare, basically anything you put on your skin, you should assume absorb systemically. With those changes, though, I think he did find a measurable improvement in his markers. And that's the message that I want to make sure your audience gets, is you don't have to become OCD living in a bio bunker, being concerned about contamination.
You pointed to the decline of testosterone, and associated with that was the decline in fertility. Could one claim that the two may not necessarily be associated, because the decline in fertility could be also due to general preferences perhaps that couples have in choosing to have either fewer children or having children later down the line? What would you say would be the counter argument to that?
Yeah, so that's a good point. We should separate out, though, the sociocultural phenomenon of people delaying children and preferences, because what I'm talking about is literally analyses of sperm count, right? So regardless of your preferences, there's a certain amount, concentration of sperm per milliliter of seminal fluid, and that's out of your control, right? So that, on an apples-to-apples comparison between men in the 1970s and men in the 2020s, is drastically different. Put it this way, back in the day, people used to have sperm counts that were over 100 million per milliliter. And now it's like in the 40s. It's so drastic of a change that it cannot just be explained by even if you feel less masculine, that's not going to drastically change that. So there's something going on here. Now, to your point, is that necessarily independent of testosterone? It could be. They are orthogonal constructs. I would say they're highly correlated. And if you understand the physiology of the hormone pathway, the hypothalamus releases GnRH. So that's a master hormone. And that drives the pituitary to produce both LH and FSH. So if that primary top of funnel is affected, we're producing less GnRH, which is, I think, what's happening. You're going to get less LH and FSH, which the LH is responsible for the production of testosterone. The LH is, FSH is responsible for the production of sperm. So if it's happening at the top of the funnel, you should actually see a decline in both. Now, if it's happening below the pituitary level, where something is affecting, let's say, FSH, but not LH, it would be plausible. I think this is happening at the same time, at the same rate, in a probably a similar mechanism of action, that I almost think it's impossible that it's not going hand in hand. And it's generally a larger function of essentially testicular damage and function that's happening.
Speaking about the crisis of masculinity, and we've spoken about the decline of testosterone, to what extent can you piece together mental health issues amongst males today with decreasing testosterone in an environment where there are other sociocultural factors at play?
Yeah, that's a great question. And this is where it gets speculative, where that trend is also happening, in that there's an increase, at least observationally, of mental health issues. Men seem to be struggling in terms of factors of functioning, educational attainment, workplace attainment. Women are basically outclassing and surpassing men in a lot of ways. In fact, majority of medical school enrollees are now women, which is great. There's no problem with that per se. But I think you see a lot more boys, especially, I would say, struggling in their primary years than ever before. Now, is that because of the testosterone decline? We don't know, to be honest, because to your point, there are a lot of other socio-cultural factors. But it does at least encourage us to ask the question in the first place, when literally boys are less male. And we know this because it's not just testosterone and sperm count. Literally the angiogenital distance in infants is decreasing. This is the distance between the anus and the genitals, angiogenital distance, which is the hallmark essentially of maleness. That's the main, what's one of the key phenotypic differentiators between boys and girls when they're born. And that is literally shrinking. Right. So literally infants and babies are becoming less male, maybe due to in utero changes in hormonal environments or milieu. And so you can't help but think, how does that change one's life trajectory, literally, when we're born less male? And we don't know, but you can't help but wonder, if you're physically in a measurable way less male, what does that mean for your life path and outcome, how you see yourself, how you feel as a man, and how you operate in the world? We don't know the answers to these questions, but I think when it's such a drastic, obvious, measurable, whether it's a biomarker or in this case, an external, literally something that you can see with your own eyes, we should do more research and investigate this question, because I don't know if as a society we should be okay with this drastic change, especially because, to your point, even if people are choosing to have less children or to have them later, what people are running into is, because of this fertility crisis, they can't have children if they want to, or they're going to require significant amounts of IVF or have significant struggles essentially in doing so. And what does that mean for the future of society? I think we're already running into a lot of negative consequences.
You introduced a term, tonic masculinity, at a time when toxic masculinity was trending. It was almost a contrarian move. One could argue it was mildly provocative. I think you were trying to illustrate a deeper point, which spoke again to certain sociocultural elements. Could you elaborate on that?
Yeah, it was interesting. The whole toxic masculinity movement came at a time. it was really pushed by two particular organizations. I think Gillette popularized it in a commercial, which was largely panned. If you actually go look it up on YouTube, type Gillette toxic masculinity and read the comments, which I think gives you a good unbiased view because they're not filtered, of how most people felt about it. And they felt like it was attacking men. It was part of the Me Too movement. And I think that was a very understandable and quite frankly, laudable movement. There are legitimate issues in our society that we should address. The problem with that is that got confounded with masculinity, which has nothing to do with masculinity. Sure, obviously the purveyors of more physical violence are men, given the physiological stature. Although women are no less violent than men if you include emotional violence. That women just have a different type of aggression. It's more passive aggressive than it is physically aggressive. That's a thing that people don't understand. But if we're talking about more obviously sexual and physical violence, yes, of course, men are greater perpetrators of that just by difference of who we are. But to turn that into a problem of masculinity is, I think, where the argument really started to get very loose and also became very problematic because the American Psychological Association, I'm like, sure, a razor company is going to put out a provocative ad to troll people and get controversy. And even if it's honestly insulting, all attention is good attention when it comes to how a lot of companies operate, even if it's unethical. So I understand why they did what they did. In fact, I bet my hypothesis is they knew that they were going to get backlash, but good. It's all good attention.
Indeed.
What hurt me is someone who has graduated from a APA accredited residency program. This is the governing body of all psychologists. One of their divisions put out a statement saying that essentially masculinity is toxic, the way that we raise boys, and it's particularly interestingly like virtues. I believe it was like courage, competitiveness, aggression are inherently toxic. We should be discouraging boys and having curriculum and other training to almost wean it out of them, which I was like, I don't think there's good psychological research to convey that point. I think it was a couple of rogue psychologists, quite honestly, part of that division, who put out that statement, made it seem like it was representative of everyone in the APA, and were really quite frankly pushing an agenda. To me, I'm like, these are inherently male qualities, competitiveness, drive, aggression, but it's how you channel it. You can channel it in a positive, productive, and pro-social way into sports, into succeeding at your career. They're not inherently toxic or harmful to society. Obviously, if you do it in a way that's illegal, unethical, immoral, harmful to others, but that's literally what parenting, education, therapy is all for. And so it was quite frankly a silly view. I think a lot of even my peers and professionals thought so. But I think it was honestly lapped up by the social zeitgeist at the time, which is very anti-male. And you even saw this, though, concerningly in how organizations, particularly I would say in Silicon Valley, were operating. And essentially, there was an unspoken rule that we need to quota hire. We need to rebalance genders that to achieve a perfect 50-50 split. And as a result, there was basically unsaid ban of hiring men in a lot of industries, including, I would say, venture capital and in the technology industries. The irony of that, though, was it was completely not data-driven. Funnily, I love to share this anecdote. Google actually did a study because people were complaining about the pay gap, right? Men are paid more than women, which is, by the way, it's been disproven. If you correct for ambition and the types of jobs that obviously men are more inclined to do finance jobs and get paid more, there is no pay gap. And in fact, the irony that slapped Google in the face is when they looked at Google itself, women were paid disproportionately more and unfairly than men in equal roles. So it was the complete opposite. And they actually had to correct for that because they had basically what happened, they'd overcorrected. I think that was a very symbolic story of it made sense. I think it came from a good place to want to undo historical wrongs, overcorrected in the other direction and literally discriminating against men, which ironically to me is that's the toxicity that you're seeing in society. And my point is not to be contrarian or provocative for provocativeness sake. It's to just be a truth teller. I always say that the last two truth tellers in society are psychologists and comedians. Psychologists can speak freely privately and comedians can speak freely publicly because they can get away with saying it's a joke or it's for entertainment. But we've become hypersensitive as a society to being able to have articulate debates, to be even to make these points. The points that I'm making now are quite frankly probably unpopular still to these days, even though it's empirically and factually true. You can look up all these case studies and statistics later. But I thought it was just very important for someone, especially who has institutional credibility, has a large public following to be able to speak truth to power, as they say, and tell these unpopular truths, because I think they're uncomfortable truths that our society was not willing to face. I was a relatively apolitical person prior to these culture wars happening. I almost felt like I couldn't help but getting sucked into the fray of the conversation. But I just felt, as a values-driven person, I literally teach and practice values-based therapy, acceptance and commitment therapy ACT, which the whole philosophy is, look, you got to live according to your values. That's how you find meaning and fulfillment in life. And so for me, I was like, I find value and fulfillment in my job, but there's something wrong with American society and I have to speak up about it. And quite frankly, it's been hurtful in terms of some of the blowback that I've gotten, but I would say 95% of the feedback has been incredibly positive. And the most interesting thing I can share is there's a tremendous amount of people, including a lot of people that you probably know, who will DM me privately and say, I agree 100% with what you say, but I can't retweet your stuff because my job would be at risk. But I was like, what happened to society where that's true? Where I would say 80% of Americans agree. 80% of Americans are neither extreme left nor extreme right, which are, I think both sides are quite frankly crazy. I'm a moderate, to be honest. But I think the rational middle, if you will, cannot speak up anymore because everyone's terrified.
There seems to be a surge in certain trends that have become part of the current zeitgeist. This fixation with morning routines, bedtime routines, seeing alcohol change as a status symbol compared to what it was before and what it is now. And also as well as sleep behavior. Once in the past, it was about hustle culture, not getting enough sleep. And right. That was a certain kind of signal. And it seems to have almost done a 180. Why do you think that is, this optimization or over-optimization era? And to what extent do you credit this to certain maybe influencers or science communicators who have landed in this space?
I think it's overwhelmingly driven by a few, literally a handful of influencers. The thing that I find interesting as a psychologist is why have a few people in the span of literally a few years, people came out of nowhere, captured the public attention so much and that they've literally become America's doctor and basically dictate the recommendations and are more powerful than the American Medical Association, I would argue. Any public health guidelines, if you think about it, nobody listens to the nutritional guidelines that the government puts out. Maybe they do, maybe to a vague extent. They don't know them by heart. But I would say a lot of educated people are sitting there and listening to certain podcasters, and that's how they decide what to eat, how to exercise, what their morning routine is, whether alcohol is good or bad. It's like a church, I would argue. And they follow it like it's gospel. That's fascinating to me because I'm like, how did this happen? They're literally like cult leaders. The only difference is that you don't have to have an official membership, but if you're a follower, that's basically the new membership. You don't need to be a card carrying member. If you subscribe on YouTube or on Spotify, you're essentially a de facto member of their cult. And I think to me, where does the ideology of that start? It's a couple things. There's a loss of institutional prestige and mm-hmm. credibility. Nobody trusts the government anymore. Nobody trusts the CDC after this whole coronavirus epidemic. Institutional distrust that is at an all-time high. And I think it's promulgated because legitimately the government sent very confusing messages. Is masking helpful? Is it not helpful? They literally went back and forth. Do vaccines work? Do they not? Doesn't it prevent spread, catching it? Maybe it prevents severity. And I think a lot of this mistrust that was engendered moved the needle to trusting individuals. So, well, if I can't trust institutions, who can I trust? I can trust individuals. And the pushing of certain influencers to national prominence and fame by being knighted or tapped by Joe Rogan and the kind of the kingmakers, if you will, have pushed them to the forefront. And because the scientific community and the medical community, in my opinion, have failed the public. We cannot agree on what to eat. We cannot agree on what the nutritional recommendations are, even amongst ourselves. And so that creates a void, a gap for an influencer to come along who is not even a clinician, right? Doesn't treat patients to say, here are all the things you should do. Ice baths, saunas, all these like just nonsense kind of things. And people will listen because at least they have some institutional credibility. They sound articulate. It seems to be based in science. Nobody's like actually questioning the methodology of these papers, but they're like, hey, look, I just need to know what to eat, what to do, how to exercise. And there's a smart professor man telling me what to do. And it sounds good. And everyone else seems to be listening to him. So I too will join the church. I will become an apostle and I'll follow it. And so to me, it's just like people want guidance. They're thirsty for guidance regarding health and they do want it to be scientific. And I think because we failed as a scientific and academic community to effectively communicate evidence-based consensus positions that are clear, that are articulate, that are non-contradictory, that don't change whether you should eat eggs or their cholesterol is good or bad for you. That's also caused distrust amongst the people. I think it's created an opportunity for these influencers to come in. That's why I actually make the analogy to religion. When you don't have strong communities, strong faith, it's very easy for a fly-by-night preacher to come into your town, seduce all the pretty women, the guys to give up all their fortunes and then run away. And I see that similar hucksterdom happening in this era. But to me, I don't even blame the influencers, right? They're just taking advantage of an opportunity. To me, I'm like, why have we failed as an academic and medical community to provide clear, consistent advice? And so it's created opportunities for influencers to become the new gods. And I think it's a very sad reflection on the failure of medicine to do true public health.
You said, for example, that institutions or medical organizations, they haven't been great in the communication of evidence. Individuals are more likely to listen to influencers or podcasters about nutrition as opposed to the official nutritional guidelines. But I suppose even you perhaps wouldn't agree with the official nutrition guidelines, no. Right? If we look at intake about vegetables, red meat, etc., right. You'll have a certain viewpoint on it, which will be informed by evidence. But that certainly does disagree with the medical organization, institutions, and what they're saying. So to take the other side of the argument, if you like, could one not make the claim that influencers are providing a need or a service that's severely missing? There are individuals, yes, who have followed sort of their protocol, their advice, and they have benefited because no one else seems to be catering for them.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, I agree with you. And like I said, it's because the guidelines aren't consistent and clear. And quite frankly, it's created a space for them. And don't get me wrong, not all influencers are bad. There's great influencers, there's terrible influencers, and there's everything in between. The danger, though, I think, is it's too much power in the hands of individual people. And also, if you understand the business model of influencers, the people who are doing it primarily as a living, they literally make a living out of it. That creates two incentives. One, the more outrageous they are, the more they sell. So basically, this is the problem with the whole health influencer field. If you're a true evidence-based health influencer, what are you going to promote? Sleep right, exercise, eat well, really basic fundamental things. And that gets boring after a while. You can do maybe 5 podcasts on that where you, I don't know, maybe 20, where it's like, how much can you just talk about the need to get 7 to 9 hours of sleep and the many different biohacks and supplements? At some point, you exhaust yourself. And so now what do you have to do? You have to get into more and more exotic shit. You're like, okay, now let's talk about infrared saunas and icing your balls and the more weird shit, because it's more provocative. This one weird trick, if you've ever seen those ads, because that's what people want. That's what engages in clickbait. I think it takes even very evidence-based, rational people. Dr. Oz is the best example of it. Legitimate cardiologist shills random bullshit supplements on TV. And you're like, how did this guy, who was legit, but I don't even necessarily blame him, although you can argue about his individual ethics and selling his soul. But if you are going to be successful as a TV guy selling to middle America, middle-aged women in the middle of daytime TV, you got to be like, here's this one weird weight loss trick, because that's what an obese housewife wants. You have to cater to your audience. And so it draws people and almost corrupts them. That's the danger of the individual. And when it's one person versus a group of people, I think it's easier to corrupt one individual. The second problem is they have to make a living, right? And so what do they make a living on? Selling stuff. What are they going to sell? Athletic greens, right? So some company has to sponsor this podcast that they're doing, and they have to shill green juice, literally, and say, it's great. I take it. This is why you should take it. Maybe it's great. Maybe it's not. But they're no longer objective. There's clear biases. The tricky thing nowadays is the difference between an ad and what's not an ad has become blurred. At the beginning, right, of their podcast, they may hold up a bag of athletic greens and say, obviously, I'm paid to promote this. But the rest of the podcast, the thing that people don't realize is an ad. Because what I do at the beginning of the podcast, I skip over the ads. I'm like, I don't want to listen to this shit, because I know it's like you're completely biased and you're selling this because they're probably paying you a lot of money. But what's the rest of the podcast? What's the magic supplement that's going to help me fall asleep? People forward to that. They're not skipping it. They're like, tell me, what is it? What's the type of magnesium? What's the dosage? And then, oh, coincidentally, you're sponsored by a supplement company where I can go buy that supplement. So that's the funny and very clever thing that they've done. Instead of ads interrupting the podcast or the TV show, the podcast has become the ad. And people want to watch the ad because they're looking for that magic pill to improve their life. And it's not that some of the recommendations are bad. I actually think magnesium is a great thing for sleep, but some of the things are not. The consumer can't tell the difference because, again, it's a prestigious professor and he knows better than me. He's looked through the research and he sounds credible. And I'm not going to sit here and pour through the studies unless you're really going down the rabbit hole. I think that what's caused the perniciousness of this is the influencers essentially, by definition, have to become corrupted by their business model. That's why when I try not to be an influencer, but I am public about it. I'm like, look, I make my money through my business. I make my money through my private practice. The social stuff I do for free. And I'm not making any money off of it. Sure, obviously, I'm going to promote some of my own stuff because it's in my business interest to do. I'm very clear about that disclosure. But I think if your primary business model is to be an influencer, that's where you're making your money, is through your podcasts and your books. I would encourage people to be more skeptical of those folks if they don't have a primary source of income, or that's not their main source of income, I should say.
What I also find pretty fascinating is I sometimes see comments where they're asking questions. Should I be viewing morning sunlight for 5 minutes or 7 minutes? Should I be in an ice bath for 10 minutes or 8 minutes? And this is not a critique, and I'm not trying to dunk on anyone, but I just found it an interesting observation between the effort put in splitting hairs between some of these practices versus the return that you could get on just doing the boring, basic things that you know already what to do.
I think it actually makes a lot of sense if you understand the psychological root of it. Because I see the same thing. People are so upset. Literally, people will DM me and will be like, okay, there's 7 types of magnesium. Which one's the best? And the thing is, it's not a crazy thing. You're like, okay, maybe I want to do my research. Maybe I want to make this decision once, and then I'll stick to that freaking form of magnesium for the rest of my life. It's not a terrible thing, but the line gets blurry because now you're doing that over, how long should I stare in the sun in the morning during my whatever morning walk? And what happens if I only get 5 versus 7? And it becomes this psychological inflexibility. I think very much it's a symptom of orthorexia, or basically OCPD. It's pathological perfectionism. And the question is, true OCPD in terms of its base rate in the population is actually pretty rare. Like single digit percentage of people are truly pathologically perfectionistic and obsessive. But now I would say, if you think about it as a spectrum, there's a wide array of people, particularly if you isolate it to educated white collar professionals. I almost feel like half of them are like obsessed about their health in a weird way, to your point. Not that they're actually doing the things that they need to do, which is getting 7 hours of sleep. It's like, how long should my ice bath be? And you're like, to be honest, probably no good research on it. Like some of these practices are so new that, and some of these new supplements are so new that there isn't a lot. So honestly, it's your best guess. And the irony, by the way, of this whole too, is even if there was research, the individual responses are so different. If you understand standard deviations, is that it probably doesn't even apply to you, because you're like, even your pharmacokinetics are highly determined by your genes and what else you're taking. So I'm like, even the research doesn't apply to you, as always. People don't understand the depths of the scientific intricacies of that. And they're trying to find answers for things that sometimes may not have an answer unless you're literally experimenting on yourself. So going back to your question, what is the root of all this? We live in a world that's chaos, right? The world is out of control. We've been under a pandemic for 2 years, even beyond coronavirus. Even amongst my colleagues and friends, people who are healthy, never get sick for years, are getting all kinds of colds, flus. Like, our immune systems are at assault. The world is at war. We're in very troubling and unsettled times. And I think that basically the base rate of anxiety is at an all-time high. And so what do people try to do when their anxiety is high? They try to control it. And maybe not always directly, but they try to control what they can control. And the best example of this is eating disorders. What is the highest proportion of people who have eating disorders? They're educated women who come from smart, tight-knit families, go to good school. It's like the people who you wouldn't think so. And it's like the people who have perfect lives. So why are these women becoming anorexic or bulimic? It's because the pressure on them is so high that the one thing that they can control in their lives is what they put in their mouths. So if they have parents that are like controlling, or maybe emotionally unavailable, or whatever's going on in their life, they can control their food and they become eating disordered. So it actually makes a lot of sense if you understand the psychological underpinning. I think that same phenomenon is happening with biohackers and they don't even realize it. They feel out of control with their lives. Maybe their relationship isn't going well. They're not where they want to be in their careers. Why am I tired all the time? Because maybe I have long COVID and I don't understand what's going on in my life. I can't find a girlfriend because dating apps have dramatically changed the sociological structure. And most men, the top level men, are sharing 2 women, and a lot of men essentially have no women. All of this is happening at the same time. Men and women feel out of control. Women can't get men to commit because they're being shared. And all this chaos is happening. And the one thing you can control is how long you're sitting in your cold shower. I think if you understand that from a psychological perspective, you're like, I understand why you're nitpicking. I understand why you're sitting there on YouTube being like, tell me what form of magnesium to take. Because at least if I get this one thing, I feel like I'm doing something right for myself. I have control over this element of my life, even though I can't, I'm bringing order to chaos. And I think people don't understand that. But when you understand that, it gives you the freedom to realize this isn't solving anything. It's an illusion. It's a trick that I'm telling myself that it's almost like a self-soothing that I'm engaging myself. I think that's why people love the morning ritual. They have this fantasy that if I just have the perfect morning ritual, my life will be complete. My day will be infinitely productive thereafter. I'm going to be like Tony Robbins screaming. And that's the thing. And that's why I said a tweet and I was like, ironically, the people who don't have a morning routine and their mornings are chaotic, those are the people who need a morning routine. And the people who are obsessing about their morning routine, about how long should I stare in the sun, those are my patients where I'm like, you don't need a morning routine. In fact, my recommendation is to get it out completely because I know you're overdoing it. And so that's the funny thing. Different people need the opposite thing because what they really need is psychological flexibility. And I think if you understand the underpinning, which is, like I said, it's people's unconscious effort to bring order to a chaotic personal and environmental world, then you let go of essentially this unconscious and quite frankly, immature coping strategy and say, look, 20-80 rule. What are some basic things that I can do with my diet, exercise, sleep, stress, and intimacy? What I call the five foundational health behaviors that don't take a lot of time, less than 5 hours a week, and I can be healthy, happy, and not an obsessive freak and live my life. That is what a mature, responsible adult should be doing, not nitpicking over the little things.
How do you see this calibrating out going forward? Do you think there's going to be competitive market dynamics where other sort of science communicators, influencers who are sort of part of this particular space, that they're going to provide some balance to what's going on at the moment? Or do you think it's literally going to be like the winner take all dynamic? And then you have, as you've described it, a church with a certain prophet at the head and then other individuals following suit?
Yeah, I think there's going to be different prophets, as you will. I think what makes people famous is not the quality of their content. I think it's, like I said, I think they're literally manufactured. Just like Oprah made Dr. Phil famous. He's not the best psychologist. Even by his own attestation, he's like, I was a terrible therapist. That's why he was doing jury selection, which is a very interesting like little niche, right? It's not therapy. He's not an empathic person if you watch his show, but he's literally the number one and best paid psychologist in the country because he knew the right people and knew how to promote himself. He's very good at what he does in terms of being a salesman, but he's not, I was like, I can list 100 psychologists that are better to listen to. And they're wonderful, amazing people. Go listen to Francis Weller, for instance, if you want to learn about grief on YouTube. He's like the most poetic. And I was like, man, I would have him be my therapist. Nobody knows about him though, right? Mm-hmm. Because he doesn't have a nationally syndicated television show. And that's the sad thing is you really got to like talk to people in the field about who do you follow? Who would you go to as your doctor, your psychologist, or your therapist? And follow those people. Because the people that are famous are literally the equivalent of pop singers. There are great musicians out there, if you're like into underground hip hop, that are better than the trashy money, cars, and hoes stuff that's put out in the top 40. But you got to make the effort to find them. So that's my message to people is don't just follow the biggest people, because people make the mistake that the more famous they are, literally just like top 40 artists or top 40 hits on Billboard, the top 40 podcasts are probably trash. It's pop. It's catchy. It's enjoyable because they figured out the formula to make it interesting to listen to, but it's not quality music. Just like it's not quality podcast, it's often not quality material. Or if it was at the beginning in order to get famous, it's now been corrupted over time by the financial incentives that I've mentioned over time. So I think that's happening. I do think you're seeing, to your point, a backlash against these 2 to 4 hour podcasts. I'm like, listen, I'm a clinician scientist and I'm not going to listen to someone talk about lipids for 4 hours. I was like, the average person does not need this level of scientific intricacy. And again, I think it's just, if I just listen to this 16 hours of exercise physiology that I can have, it's almost like soothing. It's numbing in some ways. I do think you're seeing good people. I'll give an example, Chris Masterjohn. He does go deep into the science, but he's put out this little series lately, which is just like the, I'm giving you the 5 minute, okay, what do I do, snackable version of nutritional supplements instead of talking about 2 hours of trace metals that nobody needs to know. You probably see this with me as well, because I live at a weird intersection of my company could be considered biohacking. We don't call it that. I think it's health and performance optimization, because I'm like, look, there are simple things that move the needle that are worth the time, effort, and money. And there's a lot of things that you shouldn't be doing, like the ice baths and the saunas. I think it's just way excess for majority of people who basically are not professional athletes. I actually went to Upgrade Labs yesterday, derivative bulletproof. I've tried all this, by the way. I literally did cryo yesterday, red light therapy, PEMF, compression therapy. So one, I don't criticize anything I haven't tried. But like I said, it's splitting the hairs. And I was like, yeah, if you're not training to be a professional athlete, the average Joe Schmo mom and pop just need to take care of the basic fundamentals. And so I think there's a lot more. I'll give you another example of a guy I really like, Ted Naiman, a physician here in the US, promotes very simple dietary rules. He's, I exercise 10 minutes a day, body weight, no gym. And the average person can just do that. And I was like, yeah, that's way better than these podcasters that are telling people to do 3 hours of zone two cardio on top of lifting multiple times a week. And I was like, nobody has time for that. If you've ever been an actual clinician, work with real patients who like, they're not going to do shit. You're going to tell them, okay, man, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, this is all I, or maybe a few times a week. That's all I can realistically get the majority of people to do. And that's all you need to do. If you're trying to be a professional bodybuilder, sure, I'll give you a whole different routine. For the average person, they just really need to do basic stuff. And I think the more sensible people, they're not going to win out over time, like I said, because there's going to be pop singers who put out trash and they're going to always be popular. But I think the smart people who care about their time and they care about not being obsessive and they care about, honestly, spending time with their families, which is what they should be spending their time on instead of freezing in an ice bath, are going to follow the people who are sensible and have and develop routines that are sensible as well.
I wanted to move this a bit forward towards Fight Club. I know Fight Club has a special place in your heart, as it does mine. And we've been speaking a lot about self-improvement and describe self-improvement as a form of masturbation and rather self-destruction is where more attention should be paid. Can you elaborate a bit more on that by what you meant in terms of self-improvement versus self-destruction?
Yeah, absolutely. So first of all, if anyone listening to this has not watched the movie Fight Club, you should go watch Fight Club. It was filmed in 2000. And I think it's actually one of the most brilliant movies and exegeses or explanations of masculinity that there is. After you watch the movie, there's actually a great YouTube explainer because the movie is actually kind of deep and you don't really catch it the first time around in that Fight Club is essentially a modernized version of Nietzsche's philosophy. And it talks about basically the emasculation of modern society that's driven by consumerism and how to overcome it through individualism, essentially, and becoming a great man. And so in a lot of ways, I think Fight Club predicted what has happened to society in the 23 years since. America was always consumeristic, but the difference was from TV now to basically having a TV in everyone's pocket and constant consumption of media, that's been essentially amplified to an nth degree. And I think Robert Bly essentially talked about this. He wrote a book in 1989 called The Sibling Society. And he talks about how essentially there's a lack of male role models and father figures, both at the national level in that we don't even respect our politicians very much anymore, but also literally at the head of the households. Because of the divorce rate, most fathers are not physically present, or even if they are present, they're probably emotionally absent because they spend all their time working. And so when he comes home, you get his temper instead of his temperament. And so in a fatherless society, there is no paternalism anymore. And siblings compete not to be good, to please the father and be the good boy or good girl, but they compete to become famous. And that's essentially what I think you're seeing in the TikTok and YouTubization of society, in which the number one job that young people aspire to is no longer to be an astronaut, doctor, scientist. It's to be a YouTube vlogger. That's the number one thing that people aspire to. People so want to be famous. And I think that's a very actually symptomatically ill thing of society. There's nothing wrong with celebrities, but it should be 5% of people who do that. It's a very niche thing. Not everyone should try to be famous, but in the era where everyone has an Instagram, everyone can post a story, and a lot of people are trying to become famous to varying degrees, I think you're seeing mental health rates go out of control. And I think Fight Club essentially touched on a lot of this, right? And so as we were talking about the excesses of biohacking, there's a great quote. It's not in the movie. It's actually in the book version of Fight Club, which is also great. I highly recommend it by Chuck Palahniuk. He says, speaking to Tyler Durden, and he says, Deliver me from Swedish furniture. Deliver me from clever art. May I never be complete. May I never be content. May I never be perfect. Deliver me, Tyler, from being perfect and complete. And I love that quote, and I actually share that a lot because it speaks to the ethos of what we're saying, is we're all trying to be better people. I'm obviously into self-improvement and personal development, but not into being this perfect thing. Because what Fight Club points out is, look, we're all gonna die. This beautiful body that you're trying to build, this anti-aging thing that you're trying to fight, is honestly, from a psychological lens, a fear of death. When I see people, and I won't name names, but I see a lot of very successful entrepreneurs who make a lot of money and they can retire, and they become obsessive about living forever, come up with blueprints. To me, it's very symptomatic of a fear of death and not coming to terms with the reality that all of us are going to face, that one day we too will die. Now, it doesn't mean we shouldn't do obviously everything that we can to live a long, healthy, and noble life, but not to like basically spend 6 hours a day doing weird shit away from your family in order to try to live, squeeze out an extra 5 years and look like a vampire, quite frankly. I think that's what Fight Club was trying to get away from, is in some ways, a lot of society has emasculated men into being hyper aesthetically oriented, hyper perfectionistically oriented. And that's against the ethos of what it is to be a man. I think the beauty of men is their scars, right? We strive, we struggle, we hurt, and we wear that literally on our skin, in our sleeves, and in our personalities, that we suffer silently, but it develops character. And I think that sort of rugged individualism, toughness kind of masculinity, maybe some people think it's outdated. I don't think so. I don't think the definition of masculinity has changed, nor should change. I think the traditional masculine virtues are courage, mastery, strength, and honor have been the same for millennia. And it's just, it has to be adapted to a new modern society. I think these are all kind of important themes of Fight Club. And I think it's a much better message and ethos for the young male to follow than to obsessively concern about, as we talked about, their morning routines and ice baths, because they become obsessed with this improvement culture, right? And so in Fight Club, he talks about this, that the antithesis, or perhaps the antidote to self-improvement is self-destruction. Now, what does that mean? Not literally, you're not trying to destroy yourself, obviously, with drugs and alcohol. What he's talking about is destroying the ego, right? The ego or the self is essentially a narrative. It's a false thing. We come up with a story about who we are. I'm Dr. Cam. That's a totally made up story. Now, I sometimes fuse with that ego because it's useful in a public audience to be like, okay, fine, you want credibility? I have all the degrees. And if that gets you to listen to me, I'm going to put on that white coat or that suit and play this clown game. But it's effective to do so. Even though I know it's a made up thing, you can go call Harvard and ask whether I enrolled. It's true, but does it really make me worth listening to? Not really. But if it gets my foot in the door, because you're like, I got 100 people I can listen to. Who do I trust? Sure, I'm going to trust the guy who was a doctor in front of his name and went to Harvard. If that gets you in the door, then great. Then obviously listen to me, because what I say after that is actually useful. So sometimes ego is useful. I'm not saying ego is useless. It can be very effective to fuse with it at times when it's effective. But the rest of the time, it's useful to defuse from it. And that's what he's talking about, self-destruction, is if my identity is wound up in being a doctor and I somehow fail at that, or I no longer get financial or social rewards from that, I get, let's say my license gets revoked and I get kicked out, would I become depressed and kill myself? A lot of people would, because their identity is being the doctor and being the famous guy and being the rich guy. And there, you have so much more worth as a human being and as a man, besides what you can put on the table, besides the titles and besides the professional prestige. That's where that self-destruction is really great. That's why in the movie, in order to recreate the character, he had to destroy his apartment and his collection of IKEA furniture, because he was obsessively collecting it, just like the biohackers are collecting their little biohacks. It's the same phenomenon psychologically that's happening. There's a great scene in the movie where he says, only after you have lost everything are you free to do anything. And Mike Tyson talks about this too. He's, I had to hit rock bottom in order to grow and mature as a man. He was completely out of control. Now he's a very sagacious, wise, older dude. And he had to go through a lot of struggle to do. And that's what makes men, I think, better. That's what real self-improvement is destroying these false sense of self and ego that we have, getting away from this silly perfectionism. That's what true self-development and personal improvement is. Not this vampiric fear of death and aging that I think a lot of people are doing. And in some ways, it feels like you're making progress, but you're not. So that's my message to young men out there. Don't be afraid to get your hands dirty. Don't be afraid to get your skin scarred. Don't be afraid to fail and take risks. that's what being a man is. And that's the best hack that you can do, is just run into the face of the fire and you'll be molded from it better than any sauna or ice bath can make you.
I was going to ask you, what contrarian piece of advice would you provide? But I think in our conversation, you seem to already ticked all those boxes in providing a fair share of opinions, I think, that are refreshing, yet would be considered contrarian. Dr. Cam, thank you so much for your time. It's been pretty much a no-holds-barred conversation, and really appreciate the insights that you've dropped here. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Thank you so much. And my final statement is, don't even listen to me either, right? I hope some of what I take is useful, but I really love Bruce Lee's philosophy from the Tao of Jeet Kune Do, which is take what's useful and leave the rest. So if there's a slice of what I say that's helpful, I hope you take that with you. If there's a slice that's helpful from other influencers, take that with you and do the best that you can for yourself.